Também os convidados, os senhores professores aqui presentes e ainda todos aqueles que nos acompanham à distância pela internet agradecer em especial o convite e o desafio que o Sr. Diretor-Geral me lançou para moderar este debate. Again, good morning, Professor Tony Gardner. Thank you for being here with us in this international conference. We are very pleased to welcome you as invited speaker. O professor Tony Gardner vai, como já foi referido, partilhar connosco a conferência intitulada Teaching and Learning Elementary Mathematics. O professor Tony Gardner é um matemático britânico, independente, com reputação internacional pelo seu trabalho com alunos, professores e no desenvolvimento curricular, tendo ocupado até recentemente a posição de leitor de matemática e de educação matemática na Universidade de Birmingham. Dedicou os últimos 50 anos ao mundo da investigação matemática e ao ensino. Professor Gardner foi presidente da Mathematical Association, a Associação do Reino Unido para Professores de Matemática, fundada em 1871, secretário de Educação da London Mathematical Society e atualmente membro do Conselho desta Associação Britânica de Investigação Matemática. Em 1988 deu início à chamada Pirâmide de Desafios, Olimpíadas e Escolas de Verão, que desencadeia todos os anos uma variedade de 30 eventos que envolvem 750 mil alunos da maioria das escolas secundárias do Reino Unido. Foi-lhe atribuído o prémio Paul Herdles da WFNMC em 1995, tem sido orador regular e convidado da ICM desde 2004 e recebeu o Texas E&M International Award pela Excelência em Educação Matemática em 2016. Professor Tony Gardner, the stage is yours. But if you want, you can stay here, of course.
Secretary of State, Director General, fellow delegates, thank you for the invitation. Though I have to apologize, I fear if you enjoyed the last session, maybe you won't enjoy this one. Mathematics is in some sense universal. Mathematics education, however, depends in many ways on local conditions. So please do not expect me to offer simple advice about what to do and what not to do, especially since it is impossible for a stranger to understand the swings in the Portuguese mathematics education pendulum since 2010-11. Open discussion and debate are essential, but it seems that perhaps many things have already been decided. So I can only offer some comments that might help you all work towards something better. Maybe the next time you make a swing. I've nothing to sell. I have no theory of education. I have no product that is guaranteed to improve mathematics learning and teaching in Portugal. And I am certainly not a prophet who will tell you what the 21st century has in store for us. I accept the facts as Kuno drafted them. We live in a very turbulent, fast-changing world. But I am also very old, and I remember almost identical things being said in the 50s and 60s by proponents of modern math, that everything had changed in mathematics, therefore we must change things in schools. I remember the same things being said in the 70s and 80s about technology, calculators, computers. I remember in the 80s and 90s the NCTM and other people's focus on problem solving. In the UK, we've run our own experiments on many of the things which you are currently considering. Not one of these prophecies turned out to be accurate. Nobody managed to make their proposed changes work. So I may appear to you as a Neanderthal who looks to think more carefully about what it is that is permanent, that is eternal, that is reliable in mathematics education. So maybe nothing very exciting. I am sorry. But Konrad Wolfram is certainly much, has a much sexier message than I do. But he is crazy. He knows nothing about children except his own children, who are, of course, very clever, or about schools. Similarly, I would say Andreas Schleicher and Pisa, you should consider very carefully and not too seriously. Okay, on we go. I think you face three serious dichotomies, and you should be aware of them and be aware of the dangers of taking sides. Politicians and bureaucrats have, I think we almost sensed it this morning, a certain lack of sympathy with the difficulties that confront mathematics teaching. Somehow we are often viewed as the awkward children in the educational zoo. But so it is very tempting for them to accept something which avoids the details of how one makes sense of multiplication and division, of fractions, of ratio, of algebra, where we fight and we bicker and we, because it's important and it's difficult. And it's tempting to reach for global competencies, to believe that problem solving, group work, critical thinking are somehow universal solutions which are more interesting and more attractive than subtraction and decimals and trigonometry. But unfortunately in mathematics, none of these things, there is no, I will argue, there is no universal competencies that can avoid the nitty-gritty, the difficulties of details in mathematics education. Content, in the end, is the vehicle for trying to understand mathematics education and to deliver it more effectively. If there is a 21st century competency, I would argue that we have learned from the 20th century that there is one above all others, and this is mathematics. No one would have guessed in 1900 how much of the world would be taken over by hidden, invisible, but powerful mathematics. And we should remember also 2008 and the way mathematics can be trusted and abused, not only in banking, but in many other things. So the question is, what do we need to know in order to prepare people a little better for the bumps that are ahead? And I utterly reject the big mistake of identifying what is needed in adult life with what the beginner needs when they start to prepare to grow up. You need to know what they might face, but that is not the same as what you give them when they are age 5, 6, 7, 14, 15. That's a judgment one has to make. In adult life, there are many unpleasant things, which Mr. Trump can tell you all about, but you don't necessarily introduce them to your primary children. You bear them in mind. In childhood, you do many things which you do not need in adult life. I hope it doesn't offend if I say breastfeeding. Later, you don't need breastfeeding. But it seems to be a very appropriate way to begin. So what is mathematical breastfeeding? That is my question. This dichotomy is complicated by other dichotomies. There is a version of progressive left versus reactionary right. Progressive left are often the liberal educators, often teachers and education researchers. The reactionary right you often see as the conservative mathematicians. Ah, that's my picture. But this is not a helpful dichotomy. There certainly are two different approaches, but we do not choose between them and we do not take sides. Try to understand what each brings and how they have to work together. And in mathematics education, those who work with children or with teachers see what is in front of them. That is, students with their difficulties, their frustrations, their interest, their boredom. And this tends to focus one's attention on what I call bottom up. You are thinking about the needs of the students in front of you. And this is important in mathematics. You cannot just dump the mathematics on them. You have to think, where are they beginning? How can we make it acceptable, digestible to this young mind? But there is a danger, especially in Western democracies, to overvalue the feelings of the student. In mathematics, mathematics is important because of what it becomes when you have understood it more fully, what it can achieve, not only in adult life, but in science and in other ways. And so there is also a top-down version, which is more to be found among mathematicians who understand the power of the mathematics itself. They tend to forget that this is not necessarily appropriate to feed direct to children. So the concern for, if you like, the constructivist version of mathematics education, that children have to create an abstract mathematical universe in their heads, that requires one to be sensitive to the bottom-up details. But you also need to remember where you are trying to go. What is it that you want your 16, 17, 18-year-olds to be able to do, to think, to understand? And so the bottom-up and the top-down versions have to come together. So do not take sides would be my first view. And if I have an urge, it would be to, for all groups to work together, even though it is sometimes uncomfortable, and to try to hold these two things in tension without discarding either the child's view or the mathematician's view, if I can put it that way. And in particular, not to be misled by snake oil salesmen. I don't know how that translates into Portuguese, but when there is difficulty, there is always somebody prepared to sell you something which will solve your difficulty. The only question you should ask is, can I see how it actually works? So by all means, learn from other systems, but they should be systems that have made their proposal work, not systems that are dreaming that it might work, like British Columbia or whatever. There are other places going through the same process that you are going through, and so look for places which have functioning systems, not ones which have promise but no practice. TIMSS and PISA. There is all international comparisons provide very useful data. Internal data is often what you have from year to year, but it's very hard to be sure that it does not degenerate. In England, we have had continually improving performance, but measured using tests which have got easier and easier. So the improved performance is just internal tests, so it's very valuable to have the occasional international comparison. You do have to be careful. PISA, there is something not quite right about PISA. It tends to move towards global competencies. It claims to test not mathematics, but mathematical literacy, which sounds very appealing to a politician or a bureaucrat. And if you read the definition, maybe you nod and say that looks very good. But the problems that they use don't relate to the definition. And they are slightly, they're good problems, some of them. You could use them in your classroom, and they would create some very interesting work. But they seem to me to be very bad problems for comparing your classroom with your colleague's classroom. They generate activity of an interesting kind, perhaps, but not activity that you can easily compare. To compare one school with another school is more awkward. To compare one system with another system is even more awkward. Because the more interesting the question, the more dangerous the mark scheme. How is it marked? How is the student's response graded? So there is something not quite right about PISA, but still, it gives information. TIMSS gives much simpler problems, much more recognizable as school math, and so more limited. It doesn't really reach into the 21st century competencies that we have heard about so much. But what it tests gives, I think, more robust information. And if we look at TIMSS, unfortunately, Portugal took part in 95 and then again in 2011, and not in between. So two data points is always a little awkward. But the fact that they give very different numbers can only lead one to say that something good or quite good had been happening. But to interpret the second data point is very dangerous. In 2003, England saw a massive jump, not as large as yours. Yours is 100 points in TIMSS, I think. Is that right? From 95 to 100 in the average score. In 2003, England had, from 1995, I think, 48-point jump. So it's similar in some ways. Not as dramatic, but to interpret this was very delicate. Fortunately, we then have 2007, 2011, 2015, which allow you to see whether this is a random variation or whether it's a steady improvement. So be patient about interpreting such numbers. But on the face of it, you have much to think, be pleased with, and to work on, and to build on. Don't throw away. Try to improve without throwing away. So the modern world is very different from the world I grew up in. But some things seem to be very similar. The way my children bring up their children, the way they play with them, the way they read stories to them, the way they physically interact with them, these look very familiar. Even though the world they are preparing for is rather different. So certainly organisms in the early stages of life, you should hesitate before you throw away the old methods completely. Better to improve them slightly. I think I would claim, as I've said before, the only 21st century shortcut that I am aware of really is the importance of language is the same as it ever was, but the importance of science, and in particular of mathematics, should now be very clear. And so we then face the challenge of how to teach these disciplines more effectively. Not dramatically differently, not throwing things out. Be a little patient. The only systems that I know that have, and individual schools that have made a successful distinction in the way they educate their students, have essentially taken the old targets, the old goals, removed a small number of things, but achieved the old goals better by adding to the original structure. I know of no system which has rejected the original structure and replaced it by interdisciplinary work, by projects, and so on, which has made this succeed. There are plenty of examples where they have tried it and failed, from which you might learn. So a little bit about my background. I am a research mathematician. I'm not a teacher. I once said I would not last a week in an ordinary school, and promptly two teachers in the audience arranged for me to come and work in their school for 1 week. Within the first day, the head teacher had two complaints from students, which they handled very comfortably. So I'm not a teacher. My wife is a teacher, and one of my children is a teacher, so I have lived in the world of mathematics teaching very closely for 50 years. And I have interfered in schools for 50 years. I started working in the university in Tanzania in 1968, where I was required to introduce African teachers to modern math. And I realized very quickly this was a difficult task. and some of the problems. And since then, I have got involved on different levels, but I'm not a teacher. So I'm an outsider who observes. My original goal was I did a PhD in Germany and had contact with a lot of Soviet mathematics education materials. And I went back to England in 72, 73, and wanted to try to make these work in England. So my goal all the way through was to learn from other countries as best I could. When I go for a research visit for 3 months, 6 months to a country, I get into schools to try and feel what's going on. I don't understand the system particularly, but I get a bit of a feeling. So I wanted to improve things, and I started by essentially throwing everything out in my own head, and my wife and I tried to draft what God would do. But you learn very quickly that this is hubris. This is pride. And increasingly, I realized I had to learn from teachers. So perhaps my most valuable experience was to work on the school maths project with a large team of teachers working in their own time, where I was the only mathematician. And we'd meet at weekends and write materials. We produced some wonderful materials, but they turned out to be a disaster. They were used in 60% of UK schools, but we made a mistake. We forgot the central role of the teacher. At that time, primary schools had no curriculum. We had no national curriculum until 1988. And so they would arrive in grade 6, 7 with very different backgrounds. And we wrote materials which allowed them to slot in where they fitted. It seemed like a very good idea. So the textbook was just lots of little booklets, and the students could do those which they needed to do. And it destroyed the mathematics classroom, because the teacher was left administering thousands of different booklets with students all doing different things, and nobody knew what they were learning. So one learns from this: you can have a great idea, but it can go wrong, because you forget something. So increasingly it became clear to me that, if you like, the top-down view, the mathematician's view, I will call it, the idea of where we are trying to get, and the bottom-up view, which is sensitive to the interests and the needs of students and schools, have to come together. They will be in conflict to some extent, but they need to be both in the room, in order to not to lose sight of where you are trying to get. Also in England, I don't know about Portugal, but in England we tried to individualize instruction so that in each class the teacher was supposed to accept some were very good students and some were not so good, and to offer somehow a different program for these different groups. And this also was a disaster. If possible, my conclusion is that one has to learn from the Far East and from large parts of Europe to keep the class together for as long as possible, to teach them as a class, as a social unit. That is part of the joy of the mathematics, the interaction, everybody on the same page, even if some read it more quickly than others. And I think you are very lucky to have, in some sense, the natural distinction between grades 1 to 9 and grades 10 to 12. So they present rather different problems, and I hope that you will be able to try to design grades 1 to 9 so that students stay together as a as a group for as long as possible. Whether this creates problems in grade 8, 9, I don't know. That's for you to decide and how you address this. But a common curriculum for that kind of period has great advantages for the teacher and for the students. In grades 10 to 12, that's a different story. But I shan't address that here. So the lesson is everyone can and must grasp the basic abstractions. So we have touched upon TIMSS in Portugal, but we have not said the really crucial thing which you may like to reflect on. I do not know whether it applies in Portugal. But in England, we had this dramatic improvement, apparently, in TIMSS average scores in grade 4. And everybody thought this was rather good. And it continued. 2003, 2007 also increased slightly. 2007, 2011 also increased slightly. 2011, 2015 also increased slightly. So this is not something you can dismiss. Something had improved in primary school. I shan't bother you with what it was, but it was undeniable. But the important thing is that in grade 8, performance changed not at all and was weak. I think in PISA, your performance increases, but not so much. Is that about right? It's slightly up, but not very much up. And I think the message I would ask you to think about is, what is the point of an improvement in grade 4 if it doesn't lead to a similar improvement in grade 8 and in grade 12? This is top down. The goal is where you're trying to get. I am not very interested in people who achieve enormous things in grade 2 and grade 3. Well, I love them dearly, but all parents want their children to do brilliant things in grade 2 and grade 3. But it's not what matters. What matters is what you get to at the end. It's not in a marathon, it doesn't matter who's ahead after 100 meters. That's the wrong model. So what is the point of a dramatic improvement in grade 4? You want it to feed through to grade 8 and to grade 12. Now, I can only tell you what I think went wrong in England. There were great pressures on primary teachers to improve certain calculational skills and mental arithmetic in grades 1 to 4. But because there were pressures on them to get results for students to answer grade 4 type questions, they encouraged grade 3 type thinking. Because the easiest way to get an answer in grade 4 for many students is to use what I call backward-looking methods. Finger counting is the obvious bad example. For a long time in primary school, you find students still using finger counting to get answers, and they get answers, but they are handicapped. They will not be able to progress. Somehow, if you want to calculate, you have to remove finger counting and work with place value in the head. So the urge, what we forgot, was to create incentives to get teachers to push students onto creating structures in the head which would support development towards grade 8 and beyond. Yeah? So that's a confession of our own failure, and we're still paying for it. So I think a balanced curriculum has to focus on achieving serious mathematical goals at age 16 to 18 for large numbers. It's not just the specialists who need serious mathematics in grades 11 and 12. though I confess I haven't had very clear answers, but it seems to me you have an enormous number of people trying to do mathematics A who might be happier doing something different. How you get to that point, I don't know. So don't throw away mathematics A, but see if you can find a structure which allows a little bit more flexibility, rather than maybe requiring too many people to, I don't know. It's a local condition for you to consider. In the UK, the most striking positive example we have tends to be, I'm afraid it was imposed politically by the previous government and continued by the present one, which looks to the Far East to see how mathematics is taught in Singapore, in Shanghai, and elsewhere. And on the whole, it is very difficult to copy. In Shanghai, primary teachers teach 2 lessons a day. They work the rest of the time, marking and remedial work, so that this is their way they can make sure all the students are held together. So those who did not succeed in the morning get some support in the afternoon, and the next day everybody is back at the start line, more or less. Primary lessons that I have seen in England from Shanghai maths teachers have been quite impressive. They focus on one idea. They do not lecture. They involve. They're very focused on what they are trying to achieve. And on the whole, I think we can learn a lot from them. The secondary lessons, grade 6, grade 7, that I have seen, all fail in England. Again, they focus on one idea. They approach it in imaginative ways, including variations that require deeper thinking, but they assume that students have achieved a level of numerical fluency in their mental universe of number, which is not there. So that is our fault, but it means it's rather difficult to copy simply into secondary school. More interesting is the Singapore Maths Textbooks Project, where we have for 20, 30 years moved away from using textbooks. Maths teachers now view maths textbooks as embarrassing, a sign of unprofessional behavior to use a textbook. They have difficulty seeing that a textbook actually liberates the teacher to focus on teaching the mathematics. So it provides a map, a skeleton, which you can use. It's been tried and tested, so you don't have to go and make up your own exercises. And we've got into a hole with that. We use textbooks very, very little. So to introduce Singapore-based textbooks, rewritten for the UK curriculum, has been a huge support to teachers, those who use them. The teachers have begun to understand what they have always been expected to teach. They can see a progression which previously they have never seen. They have only seen curriculum items in a list. And now for the first time, they see a whole, an organic discipline. And many of them are finding it very emotional, very moving, very thrilling, very refreshing. And it's wonderful to see them using these materials with their students, holding the classes together at least until grade 4-5, where there begins to be a little problem still. Okay, so that's something somebody might want to learn from. the approaches are open, they are not prescriptive. They always start with a discussion. They adopt a kind of Confucian version of Jerome Bruner's concrete, pictorial, abstract. So each topic will start with something concrete, which may be a picture, it may be an activity. This is interpreted, well, discussed, and many ideas and answers are proposed, but there is always a target idea, which is not always made clear to the English teachers, but the textbook authors know it. From these options that come from the discussion, one is going to recur more often than the others. And the aim is to try to get this to take root. And this is done partly through pictorial representations, which use a small number of models to consistently capture different aspects of elementary mathematics. So the bar model is perhaps the most, strip model is perhaps the best known, but there are a few other partition models that are used. So the concrete is infinitely varied. The pictorial is much more restricted with three or four main models that are used as an intermediate stepping stone. The abstract, there is then essentially the standard mathematical representation. And the idea is, which we have forgotten, is that every student has to get to the abstract. We have left far too many students, this is finger counting if you like, far too many students struggling with concrete and pictorial because they can get answers from these. But what they cannot do is progress to the next level. So that model is used fairly consistently, and it's in particular the emphasis is on variations. Now this has become very fashionable, but the message in mathematics, what has been weak in English school mathematics teaching, is the temptation to treat every topic on the simplest level only.
Excuse me, Professor?
Thank you.
Okay.
Excellent. On the simplest level only, and then you discover later on that what you need for progression is that is not the simplest level, but various more elusive variations on that simple theme. And so these have tried to focus on variations. I think it's probably a good, much of that you can read on the website afterwards, perhaps. But I will repeat the comment. I think there may be 21st century skills, but none of them can be taught separately from the mathematics. So I encourage you to think how to teach new competencies or skills that you think matter through the mathematics, rather than separately from the mathematics. What cannot work, and I suppose I have to say this, is either to simply stuff more content into the same suitcase, as in an airport or going on holiday, or to treat the curriculum, the mathematics curriculum, as a piece of string and to cut 25% off the end. This you cannot do. You can reduce and you can increase, but the curriculum is an organic structure. You have to start again and make sure that the things you reduce don't have knock-on effects elsewhere. Jolly good. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much, Professor. Thank you very much for your excellent presentation, and I think maybe a bit controversial, but I'm not a math teacher, thank God. So I'm just going to open the debate. Passo-vos a palavra. Penso que haverá várias pessoas, já vejo dedos a levantarem-se, e a pedir-vos para serem muito objetivos nas questões. Estamos a chegar ao final do tempo, mas penso que me permitem, ainda que já estejamos nas 12h30, avançar um pouco mais para o debate e a pedir questões muito objetivas, por favor, porque quaisquer reflexões, comentários, etc., podem ser reencaminhados à Direção-Geral, que os fará chegar ao professor e que, portanto, depois poderão ter feedback por esse modo. Passo então a palavra.
Eu gostei de ouvir essa apresentação. Será que o maior problema que temos na matemática é o esquecer aquilo que é constante na matemática e andar sempre a fazer a introdução de modas novas, modinhas? Porque a matemática está a ser difícil, vamos facilitar a matemática, em vez de puxar a matemática para cima, criar objetivos mais abrangentes e mais difíceis, para puxar para os miúdos. Tenho a impressão que quando começa a ser difícil, pá, isto é difícil, já arranjar uma coisa mais simples, uma coisa que se possa concretizar e nunca chegamos à abstração, como falou há um bocado isso.
Desculpem, eu se calhar fui brusca demais dizendo que só admitia questões muito objetivas. Portanto, como não vejo mais ninguém, vou ter que admitir um que outro comentário, porque penso que a presença do professor terá que ser rentabilizada. Passo então aqui à professora Joana Brocard, que pediu a palavra há pouco. Aqui, por favor.
Obrigada pela sua intervenção. Eu não gosto muito da sua imagem de top-down, porque me parece que a nossa intervenção enquanto tentar que os nossos alunos saibam matemática é sempre uma intervenção no sentido de aprenderem matemática. E aprender matemática, naturalmente, é chegar ao máximo da abstração. Não se sabe matemática conhecendo apenas factos ou regras ou técnicas, têm que ser conceitos. E, portanto, nesse sentido, permita-me que lhe diga que o contar pelos dedos é importante, mas não é se for uma contagem um a um. O modelo das mãos é um modelo importante para estruturar o sistema de numeração decimal e, portanto, conseguir que, por exemplo, a nível da matemática elementar, um aluno de 8 anos consiga adicionar e subtrair sem necessitar de fazer um algoritmo, estabelecendo as relações numéricas essenciais e sim dominando as questões abstratas e, portanto, chegando ao conhecimento das relações numéricas de que o Kuhn Grawemeyer falava nos exemplos de aritmética que deu anteriormente. Primeiro comentário. Segundo comentário. Nós em Portugal, contrariamente ao que acontece em Inglaterra, temos uma tradição de currículo a nível nacional e não a nível... Sempre tivemos um currículo, e, por um lado, e por outro lado, habitualmente, temos sempre um professor em frente a uma sala. Esta é a nossa tradição e, como é natural, não corremos tão depressa ou risco, aparentemente, a Inglaterra terão corrido de ver um ensino individualizado, refletimos é na necessidade de, a partir de um grupo comum de turma, necessitar de vez em quando, fomentar alguma diferenciação. Eram só os meus comentários. Obrigada.
Pergunto se há mais alguma intervenção que ainda queiram fazer antes de devolver a palavra ao professor.
Good morning. I really enjoyed your speech, and I would like to ask if you ever consider in putting a mathematics teacher in a primary school, working together. Because in the two speeches that I hear today, I think, and everybody knows, that the problem begins when they are a little child. So, and we know that the background of a primary school is not the same of a mathematic. So why don't we put the two working together and try to do something for the children? And maybe the way that we adore mathematics will be passed to them. Because society enjoys to say that mathematics is very difficult, so you will never know it, you will never will be good at it. So maybe if they have a person that will give them the love for the discipline, maybe things will be different. Sorry.
Muito obrigada. Vou passar então a palavra à professora. Please, you can ask now.
I tried to indicate that I think improvement is actually quite difficult, but worth trying. At the moment, I spend twice as much time in primary schools as in secondary schools, but I would be deceiving you if I said this is having a dramatic influence on what happens. You're right, they are different perspectives. I don't have the competence that the primary teacher has or the sensitivity. And they don't have the same picture of where one should be trying to go. So there is some interaction, but I don't know to what extent it leads to an easy improvement. On the previous two points, I would say it's difficult to recall the precise details, but I think I have no reason to believe that you can use your own methods of subtraction and have the kind of grounding that is needed for subsequent progression. So you can certainly do this, and it should be encouraged, but the teacher has to know what forms of calculation are needed for subsequent progression. And we had this morning the example of suggesting that what ordinary students need is simply to understand the ideas of differential calculus without actually mastering differential calculus. Well, I would say look for the proven evidence. It's quite hard, and on the whole, for many students, going through the details in a way which looks very familiar to the older members present is the most reliable way of helping somebody understand the ideas behind the mathematics. The idea that you can somehow get a shortcut to get the idea of subtraction or the idea of differential calculus without working through the details roughly as we are used to seeing seems to me to be unproven and implausible. But by all means, prove me wrong.
Yeah. Vamos ainda aceitar mais alguma questão que queiram colocar, algum comentário? Sim, está o professor Jaime Carvalho e Silva.
You spoke a lot about collaboration of different groups. Can you give good examples of in England or other countries about this kind of collaboration that could serve as a good example for us?
You notice that whenever I speak about holding these positions in tension, it was with some sense of pain and suffering. I think it is always difficult. One example would be there was a report in 1995 called what was it called? Maybe Solving the Mathematics Problem, which is available on the London Mathematical Society website, I think, which brought together teachers and mathematicians and so on, trying to, at the time there was, we had our own internal wars between different factions, and this was an attempt to bring people from each group together to make a report that would serve as a reference point for to reduce the friction and to allow some progression. There was another in 2000 called Acceleration or Enrichment, which was looking at the matter of differentiation. The government policy at the time was that if a student appeared to be more able, they should move on faster. And this tended to mean they move on faster, but superficially, rather than to move at the same pace, but deeper. And that again brought together teachers and mathematicians, so bottom up and top down, if you like, trying to make sure that you don't get just outrageous comments from me or insensitive comments from somebody else. But on the whole, I think this, we see in North America and in other countries that this is a bit of a struggle which you just have to live with. Yeah.
Temos mais uma intervenção ali da professora Lourdes Figueiral. Teresa, aqui à frente.
Muito obrigada. E obrigada pela sua intervenção, que de facto nos faz tomar consciência, com alguma pena, com alguma dor, dessa crispação que existe, provavelmente entre dois mundos que eu acho que não estão condenados a não se entender. Em Portugal houve uma experiência entre a APM e a SPM num determinado momento, sobre a matemática para a formação inicial dos professores do primeiro ciclo. Eu não a vivi diretamente, mas todos os ecos que eu tenho desse trabalho foi de que foi muito produtivo, muito interessante. Só que depois entra a crispação, entra entra, de certa forma, o argumento da autoridade, como dizia Sebastião e Silva, que faz com que nos preocupemos muitas vezes mais com as nossas próprias convicções do que com as condições de aprendizagem dos alunos. Porque nós, se recebemos um aluno no sétimo ano, não podemos dizer que ele tem que desistir de matemática porque não aprendeu matemática até ali. Mas o que eu acho que é, por exemplo, um drama no nosso país, e penso que isso também é genérico, é quando se chega a um primeiro ano da faculdade em matemática, qual é a percentagem dos alunos que persistem? Porque é que não se enfrenta também? Porque isso é fundamental para aquilo que se passa nos outros níveis. Porque é que não se enfrenta a questão da matemática que se ensina no ensino superior e a forma como se ensina matemática no ensino superior e logo no primeiro ano se põe tanta gente fora dos cursos de matemática? Bem precisamos de licenciados, de mestres, de doutores em matemática que tenham esta sensibilidade, que formem futuros professores de matemática com um forte gosto por terem passado pela experiência de, na faculdade, terem conseguido gostar da forma como foram ensinados. Porque muitos de nós chegamos ao fim de um curso de matemática apesar da forma como fomos ensinados e apesar da matemática que nos ensinaram. Muito obrigada.
In English, this is called a hospital pass. That is when you play rugby and somebody throws you the ball just as a very big person is about to hit you. No, you are of course right. One should also address the questions of mathematics teaching in universities. But please do so with an open mind. One of the tensions between the bottom-up and top-down view is the top-down view of mathematics, which is not from the able students, it's from older, from university, if you like, from the mathematical viewpoint, is that you cannot escape the authority of mathematics. Mathematics tells you when you've got it wrong. There are some structures which are more potent, more powerful, more useful than others. The bottom-up view, if you are interested in trying to support the student, you can sometimes decide, oh, maybe we won't put so much emphasis on algebra or on whatever, that they find Euclidean geometry or something. But mathematics doesn't give you this option. So in a university, you don't have the choice to soften what you are teaching. In some sense, God is whispering in your ear, whether you like it or not. This is what you have to somehow try to present. And it's a very painful experience to sit, to stand in front of 300, 200, 100 people and know that they are suffering. But that is in some way inescapable. It's worth looking to see ways of improving it, but I don't think you can soften it completely. But do hold university lecturers to account and let them explain what the difficulties are, and you will get some sense of the top-down constraint is knowing where you are trying to get. The destination in mathematics is not chosen by me. In some sense, the mathematical God is whispering, this is what you have to try to convey. And if students have difficulty with it, what do you do? Well, you should not just complain, that's certainly true. But by all means, shine a light on university mathematics teaching. It can only benefit.
Muito bem, eu vou ter que dar como terminada a ação, agradecendo a participação do professor e esperando que estas últimas palavras dele se transmitam durante o resto da sessão, ou seja, não basta queixarmos, é preciso trabalhar nomeadamente em conjunto e é para isso que aqui estamos hoje. Termino, muito obrigada, professor. Batemos só uma salva de palmas para agradecer.
E retomamos às 14 horas. É só. Obrigada.